Well, there are two stories of how Ashby got its name. We do not know which is true. Gunder asks, who was the father of Ole, asks, was speaking to Jim Hill, the railroad president. Jim Hill took a fancy to Gunder, and he wanted to know what they were going to name the town. Mr. Hill suggested that it be called Ashby. Another tale handed down to us is that Ashby was so called because it was near an ash tree. This school district was probably organized in 1874. K.N.O. Melby was elected treasurer. Ivor Holt, director, decided to have the 3 months of school in the spring of 1875, beginning in April.
Hi, I'm Mim Peterson from Ashby. I graduated in 1940, and in 1935 and 36, this was our first basketball team. And we had to play. We didn't have an auditorium, so we played in the old modern Woodman Hall down in Ashby. I was also a cheerleader that year. Then the next year, they tore down this hall, and we had to go to Dalton to play in their hall in 36 and 37. And that was kind of fun days because we had no school buses. We had to ride, catch rides with anybody who'd drive up there, and a lot of times those cheerleaders went in the back of Tony Holtberg's old meat truck just to get a ride up there in the cold weather. Well, then we didn't play for 38 and 39. They didn't have basketball. And then in 19, because they tore that hall down and built a road through town, new road through town. Then in 1940, they built this first auditorium onto the old high school. That's what they call the little gym now. And this was a picture of our basketball team then, out in front of it. And I and Harriet Langley were cheerleaders in 1940.
I taught 36 years at all. In the years that I taught, I was going to school summers most of the time, so I really didn't get to know people until after I was married and lived here. My bachelor's degree at Minnesota, and that's the one, University of Minnesota. We didn't have any tech schools or Morris or any of those. I went 4 years, borrowed money from my dad. There were very few jobs for women at that time. If you wanted to be a waitress, you had part-time work. You could get housework, and they worked you too hard for the money. You'd get 25 cents an hour. And that was, we were going to university. That was Depression years. Do you people realize what salaries were in the period of the Depression for teachers? I had a master's within all I had to have was my exam at the time, and I was getting, when I moved to Crookston, I got a job at Crookston, and I was there 9 years. The first year, I got $85, and that was for 9 months. This is kind of a good joke in our family. I still have my contract, and it says, do you drink? Do you smoke? And if you get married, your job automatically stops.
Donald Johnson, a local farmer and businessman, bought a new 35-millimeter Kodak Pony camera in 1952. He carried the camera with him on his daily trips to Ashby. Before long, people became used to seeing him with his camera, and he was able to shoot many unposed photos as people went about their daily lives. His pictures captured not only the people of the time, but also the business places, vehicles, and equipment that were used in Ashby. Although many of the people in the photos are gone, many of us know their descendants. These are just some of the photos from the collection that help us recall the stories and times nearly forgotten. Longtime superintendent of the Ashby School, Cliff Bertram, has seen many changes through the years. Join with us as Mr. Bertram remembers the way things were in years past while taking us on a tour of the present-day Ashby School.
Well, when I first came, this was one large room, an assembly room, and then the wall was put in the back of the room to make two rooms out of it. For a while, there was another wall across the front, and the little part in the front was the library. This room here on the corner was the typing room. And there was a doorway through here. The small room in there was the first office. Down here, this room to the right was the science lab, chemistry, physics, general science. Then years later, they brought a schoolhouse in from out in the country, and the science lab got to be in that schoolhouse that stood on the outside of the old gym. This room on the northwest corner up here was not used when I came because they could never heat the thing. It was too cold, but later they got some radiators in there and were able to heat it, and I see they are using it at the present time. Well, that's about it upstairs here. This room here was the seventh and eighth grade room when I first came, and at that time the school was on what they called an 8-4 system. And the seventh and eighth grade were part of the elementary school. About 5 or 6 years after that, it got to be a 6-6 school, and the seventh and eighth grade then became part of the junior high and then finally the high school. And all of these rooms down below here on the three corners were elementary classrooms. And where this computer room is, that was the second office. After I came, the office moved from upstairs down here to this room here. These rooms in here were cloak halls for the elementary classrooms on both sides here. And this area here, against this wall was a girls' lavatory. And then the rest of the room was the boys and girls shower rooms. And this one was the elementary classroom. And this section here, on the farthest on this wall was the boys' lavatory. And next to it, there was another little room that was the elementary library. And next to that was another little room, and that was the janitor's room, which led into the boiler room when they had the old boiler, and that was the only thing that was heating the building at that time until they built the new gym in 65 and put in a new boiler to heat that section, and now apparently they don't use this one anymore, and they have they heat the entire building with the big boiler that's down in the boiler room that's across from the office down there. Gym was built in 1941 as a WPA project. That was here when I came, and on this side here were the bleachers. Then when we built this middle section out here in 1953, we put a wall through the gym here. This side was the music room. That side was the lunch room. And we closed off the stage and divided that in half. And the right-hand side was the kindergarten room, and the left-hand side was practice rooms for music. 1953, this middle section here was built, and the gym was remodeled, and the place between the two buildings was closed in. And this room was the first grade room. This room still is the home ec room. And this room to the right over here was the shop, ag shop. Then we cut off a section of the home ec room, and then this was the office after it moved from the first floor into here. This wall was put in on the end of the home ec room in this section, and here was the office. Where the double doors are down there, that was the outside entrance, and the school buses used to come around the building and load on that side of the building. Then in 1965, why the boiler room on the right-hand side, the offices and the new gym was built, and the boys and girls shower rooms down below the gym. And after that, why whatever additions came on were raised.
The Kitson Hotel is one of the truly historic landmarks of Ashby, with a very interesting beginning, as recounted for us by Alice Dobbs.
They were salesmen, and they used to come in. They used to come for hunting in the fall a lot. They stayed up there. And they always played cards. And they were real rich, you know, and they decided that they would play, and the one that lost was supposed to build the hotel, and Kitson lost out. They had to build the hotel. But this was the place where all the salesmen stayed. And then they hire the horses and go to the different towns around here. Sometimes they'd have to stay overnight, you know. All the bedrooms were furnished with black walnut, and was a dresser and a chest of drawers and a washstand, you know, and they had all this little bowl and a pitcher with the water in and a spittoon in every room. And then it was red, bright red plush on all the floors for the carpeting.
Hunting has always been a favorite pastime of Ashby area residents. These photos capture some of the success stories of outdoorsmen from years gone by. Since 1919, Ashby American Legion Post 357 has been actively involved in the community. Through the years, a number of Ashby citizens have served in our country's military. The Ashby American Legion Museum was built in their honor.
I'm Richard Runningen with the Ashby American Legion Post 357. Back in 1985, we had a major renovation of the building to include the hall, the new kitchen, and the bathroom. It was decided at that time to have an open house in which all the Legion members were asked to bring in items from the military, what were awarded, or how they got it. We had just a great response on this, that it was decided to have a museum put up in the old stage area. We also got a hold of Beatrice Runningen to do all this painting in oil. And we also wanted the major changes of uniforms of all the services, Army, Air Force, Navy, Coast Guards, and Marines, so that the people could see the major changes that happened since the Revolutionary War until present date. We also wanted to incorporate in this the major battle scenes that the United States has been involved with from the time of the Revolutionary to now. Way to the left, we have the Army changes of uniforms. There were six of them, in which started at the Revolutionary War until present date. Next to that, we have the United States Air Force, which has only one change. One of the most famous battles here in Ashby, that we like to think, is the Minnesota First Volunteers, which, while at the Civil War in Gettysburg, with General Hancock standing on the hill on his white horse, with the first regiment of the volunteers from Minnesota being known mostly Norwegians and Swedes, as the Confederates broke through the lines, the commander was told to attack and block and secure the lines. Of 262 men, all fixed bayonets and charged downhill on a dead run. When the fighting was through and everything was secured, there were only 47 men remaining. The next one is the Battle of the Marne. Near France, the defense of the 3rd Division stopped the last great attack of the German army and made an Allied offensive possible. General Pershing called this one of the most brilliant pages in our military annals. The next one is the Air Force pilot getting into his airplane that was used extensively during the Korean and Vietnam War. On the Korean War, the next caption is the breakthrough at Chipyong-ni when the 23rd Regiment of the 2nd Division with French troops, after being surrounded, fought their way back to friendly lines. It was said to be the finest troop ever produced in national existence. Above that, we have the C-47, named Puff the Magic Dragon, so named because of the firepower this aircraft had. It had fixed Gatling guns, 30 caliber, 20 millimeters, 40 millimeters, and 75 millimeter cannons. When all these weapons were fired, nothing underground was standing. Of course, in the center is the most important thing that ever happened in World War I or World War II, was the U.S. Marines raising the flag on Iwo Jima. This happened in World War II in the Pacific, and Admiral Nimitz said of the men on Iwo Jima, uncommon valor was a common virtue. The beachhead landing on Leyte Islands in the Second World War was elements of the 3rd Battalion, 34th Infantry, while pinned down by heavy machine gun fire. The words were shouted, "Get up, get moving, follow me," which today is used by the infantry school in Fort Benning, Georgia. Next to that, we have the battleship Missouri, which was used extensively in covering fire for the Marines and the Army while fighting in the Pacific Ocean. This battleship was also used for the unconditional surrender of Japan, which was aboard the USS Missouri. In the Revolutionary War, one of the most famous battles was between the Bahamian Richard and the British ship Spergus. With its main mast shot off, Captain Paul Jones, said, "I have not yet begun to fight," as he ordered the two ships lashed together and hand-to-hand combat captured the Spartans. Again, we have the uniforms, the major uniforms of the changes of the U.S. Navy from the Revolutionary War to present day. This museum, which consists of over 250 line items, was dedicated to the men of the Ashby area that signed the original charter on November 12, 1919, and made this American Legion possible. The second museum was completed in 1987, when we had gotten so many items that the first museum could not hold it. All the military items we have gotten in both these museums have mainly come from the Ashby area. This one was dedicated to the men that were killed in World War I, World War II, and the Korean War from the Ashby area. There were eight of them from World War I, eight of them from World War II, and one from the Korean War. As you see in the center, we have the flag flowing, or have the flag folded in just a way to represent as if it would be presented to the next of kin. We also have on the right-hand side, starting with the Pomni Tear, which is located 4.5 miles west of Ashby. During the Sioux Uprising in 1862, this fort was used extensively. Two soldiers that were killed in the uprising are buried at this time in the cemetery. Above that, we have the nuclear submarine, the USS Daniel, which served in the Vietnam War in the Pacific. And we also have the major changes from the Revolutionary War to the present date of the Marines. The U.S. and the U.S. Navy and Marines in action in World War II on Bougainville, Solomon Islands, attacked that in November 1st of 1943 and finally securing the island in March of 1944. We have the cemetery of St. Louis, France, World War I and World War II, where men are laid to rest. Below that, we have the railroad car where peace was signed in World War I. Fighting was stopped at 11 a.m. on the 11th of November in 1918. In the center, we have the American Legion and the Auxiliary, plus other legions from the area, marching in the Centennial Parade on July 22nd, 1979. The Red Brick House, where the Germans surrendered unconditionally at Rheims, France, Allied headquarters on May 7, 1945. Above that, we have the Blue Angels flying formation in demonstrating peace with power. We have gone, as you've seen, from a wartime setting to a peacetime setting. And we will go into the Earth as it is seen from men walking on the moon, stars stating, "One small step for mankind, one giant leap for mankind." The space shuttle approaching landing strip on return from space. Later, this spaceship exploded in air seconds after launching, killing all six astronauts and the one schoolteacher in 1986. The Saturn rocket with Apollo 2 on top of the moon, on right in which the Apollo 2 did land on and return back to Earth. There are over 550 line items from the military from the Civil War until present time. The pictures of men in uniform in the battle scenes of important wars are always here to remind everybody what the members of the American Legion have accomplished while in uniform, and that we are willing to do it again to obtain peace in the world. Thank you.
I'm Jack Peterson. I play with the Ashby A's baseball team. What we want to show you here today is our baseball museum that we built in 92. And we have a collection of present and past memorabilia. Ashby has had baseball dating back, I guess, 1883 was the first mansion. So it's been around for many years. What we have here is many pictures of our past teams and most of the present, I guess, and some of our old uniforms and old gloves that were used. And baseball has been a big part of Ashby. It's been around for a long time. My grandpa played, and my dad played. I'm presently playing, and I got some boys that'll probably be playing too. Thank you.
On March 16, 1970, a special meeting was held, at which time it was voted to dissolve School District 2 and join District 261, the Ashby School District. On Saturday, July 18, 1970, a public auction was held on the school grounds, where all items and furnishings were sold, as well as the schoolhouse building with 1 acre of land. District 2 had a long life. Students were proud of their school, which was always an important part of the community, as well as their family life. Mrs. Herbert Risbrut shared memories in her poem, Farewell to Hilltop School.
The school bell rang out loud and clear as the auctioneer bellowed, "How much for this bell here?" The wind was strong and the crowd was still, for we knew it was the final ring on the schoolhouse hill. People came from far and near to bid our schoolhouse that had grown so dear. It was the end of an era, a thing of the past, but the memories would forever last. The wood-burning stove with smells of smoke, the big mean boys you'd like to choke, the smell of apples and sandwiches in the pail, the wintry winds that turned into a gale, the hill with the flowers smelling so sweet, the parties and programs that were a treat. Our education was tops in the land, a part of our heritage that will forever stand. Thank you.
The all-school reunion celebrating 75 years of Ashby School was held in conjunction with Ashby Appreciation Days, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday, July 16th, 17th, and 18th, 1993. During the next half hour, we invite you to enjoy highlights of the weekend, including old-timers baseball action, a kiddie parade, softball tournament sponsored by the Ashby Baseball Club, free community picnic lunch, joint community worship in the Ashby School, and the big parade on Sunday afternoon. Join us now as we relive Ashby Appreciation Days.
And Cracker Jack. I don't care if I ever get back. We will root, root, root for the home team. If they don't win, it's a shame. And it's one, two, three strikes, you're out at the old ball game. Thank you.
Hard, thank you.
Number one, Brandon Albani.
Hey man, that's a bird.
Number two, Jesse Bixby.
It's like Sybil Ernie, but it's head tall.
You guys can clap out there. These kids are cute.
Ernie's head tall.
Number four, Ethan Goodsey.
He's 5 feet.
Number five, Katie Richford and Jody Hinch. Number six, Alicia Pinesa.
Thank you.
Anybody clapping out there? Let's have a round of
applause for these beautiful wings that are going by. You better ask your crowd. They're proud of them. And our 1988 Queen of the Lake, Tammy Hodgson, is not there. 1986 Queen of the Lake, Jana Dolan. We didn't find her either, huh? They're out there somewhere. And the 1985 Queen, Chris Dolan. In 1984, Lori Burnett. And here is the Ashby Girl Scout on the Robert Wildering truck. And here's Otto the Otter. Flintstone. Here comes Otto the Otter. They got that one turned around, too. That is the Cape Parade winner going right by there. And the Flintstones will be over. And how about a nature of applause in this Monterey Ford? And here comes Hardware Hank. The Hardware Hank man. From Vincent's Hardware. It sounds like. And here's the first state bank of Ashby. Welcome back to Ashby. The future belongs to the educators. Nice round of applause for that beautiful float of the home. Oh, that was beautiful. The future belongs to the educators. And in the next car, we have the Brandon Harvest Queen. Let's give them a nice round of applause for this visiting dignitary here. Next month, August 6th, 7th, and 8th. That's Jenny Flatt, Stacy Otto, and Renee Debbie. And here is the class of 1953 on its float. In memory of Stan. We all miss Stanley. And here is the
Melanie!
I got Ashby senior citizen.
Melanie.
And here's both of their 1948 car, class of 1946. And that's Roger Carlton, holder of the 1968 Blue, Hughes, class of 42, class of 45 for the school of Monterey, and class of 43. Getting ahead of me. The 1951 Colt, 1965 Mustang, Franklin and Lorraine Yelby, class of 53 and 54. And here's the Ashby senior citizen. And a 1920 Model T Ford touring car, owned by Glenn Yelby, sponsored by the Quam Free Lutheran Church, 125th anniversary, August 1993. Thank you. suit.
Thank you.
truck then. How's that, louder now? Better?
Bring it up, Sheriff. Tony, give that. Watch for cars.
Isn't that something? 1933. August at Grant County Centennial Fair in 1994.
Hey, Trevor, look. Here you go.
Hey. I got Jolly Rancher.
Should have kept that good. I am. Chill.
Is that you down there, Ellery? I can't see who's in there. Yellow right there. Mike Hamilton, okay. Class of 58. All the kicks are in 86. I hear Cindy Boring. Mm-hmm. And the class of 89.
Oh my God. You must be 86.
And this is the 1952 Pontiac.
My cousin.
Taylor Rachel.
Play Zeppelin or something good. What class?
Well, I probably better get right up
there. This is a double emergency requested by the Sheriff's Department. The Rossi works water patrol on all the Douglas County lakes or out of the county as a tourist event. The Rossi is available for traffic control wherever it is. And they are sponsored by the Snack Shack and Jubilee Emporium.
Here it goes, Barbara
Crowley, Richard Wolfman, our attorney. Next, the class of 1975, horse and wagon.
Look at the over. We have two. We have, Trevor, we have over two
this
horses.
This is the class of there. Isn't that a beautiful animal?
Beautiful horses.
And this is Corey Skelton. They're from Hermitage, City Restaurant. Aren't those beautiful horses?
Ooh, Tony. Tony, throw me some candy. I have no idea.
Through the years, Ashby businessmen, community leaders, and citizens have worked together to create a strong sense of community pride. Just as they have laid the foundation, we continue to build upon it. Through cooperation, we move forward to new challenges, not leaving the past behind us, but using our history to help improve and sustain us as we travel into the future.